Welcome back to the show, poker players. Let's level up your skills. My name is Mike Brady, and I'm joined by a special guest today. He's won a record 4 World Poker Tour titles and is an end boss of large field tournaments. Thanks for joining me today, Darren Elias.
Hey, thanks, Mike. Happy to be here.
It's only fitting that our topic today is how to approach tournaments generally. You're about to learn key tips and adjustments that Darren makes throughout big tournaments, like the World Series Poker Main Event, for example. Whether you play tournaments frequently or just dabble in them, you're going to want to stay tuned for the entirety of this one. Darren and his longtime friend Nick Petrangelo just released their Road to Victory course on upswingpoker.com. Road to Victory is truly the ultimate tournament course. It has a heavy emphasis on practical strategies, in other words, how you should play against real human opponents in tournaments online and live. Darren, do you want to speak to how your course kind of differs from what's out there?
Yeah, definitely, because I think in today's solver era of poker, there's so much information and tools out there about poker theory and these GTO strategies and tools, whether it be Wizard, PO, Munker, Odin, Ruse, pick any four-letter word. Understanding theory is important and something we do talk about in this course. Definitely something we use Nick for, kind of getting this high-level theory and understanding these concepts, but the focus of my end of the course and really the course in general is these practical or applicable strategies to beat the human players actually in your game. Because I think that's really what matters. And a lot of especially mid-stakes or lower stakes players are not able to apply these advanced theory concepts directly, while I really go into how to beat the guy who's playing 60% VPIP limping around every hand.
Yeah, and if you play low stakes or mid stakes tournaments, you probably run into a decent amount of those guys, so it's pretty important stuff. So your course is laid out in a way that really follows the tournament journey. After some intro videos, you start by jumping into early stage tournament strategy, and there's a bunch of videos covering that part of the tournament. Then you move on to the intermediate stage, then the bubble stage. After that, you cover the initial in the money stage, followed by the deep in the money stage. There are definitely some strategic differences between those different parts of being in the money. And it all leads up to the final table and heads up play. I'd like to follow that same structure in this episode by asking you for one especially valuable piece of advice for each stage of a tournament. So let's get into it. Darren, what's your number one golden tip for the early stages of these large MTTs when stacks are deep and weak players are in abundance?
Well, these early stages are really a time for observation and collecting data on your opponents, starting to build player profiles, observing their patterns, their bet sizing, any kind of tells, things like that, and then making adjustments, starting to formulate in your mind how we're going to make inferences about their play and start to adjust our ranges, knowing that we're going to be playing hundreds of blinds deep against probably weak players and dealing with players who aren't going to play according to theory or what we would call our baseline strategy. So I actually have some pretty interesting charts and things like that for this part of the course on how I play these spots and how I take advantage of these multi-way limp pots, players with sizing tells where they open small with weak hands, big with good hands, and how we kind of formulate our range playing against these types of players to make the most money.
Yeah, I remember one of the very first things as I was reviewing the first videos and charts you were uploading to our shared drive for this course was you uploaded a range for button versus like a limp or two, and I was pretty blown away by how out of line you get against these limpers. I remember one hand in particular, you're over limping on the button with like 9-7 offsuit, and then you appropriately had a hand that you go over where you just over limp 9-7 off on the button and end up just running a savage line where you absolutely own someone. Can you kind of speak to any kind of specific strategies like that if any spring to mind?
Yeah. I think online players and people used to playing against solid competition and theoretically sound, fundamental, good players are going to be a little surprised when they see these ranges and how wide we can actually play in these big field live tournaments. I think live players probably be a little less surprised. Really depends on what games people are coming from, but it's all rooted in the concept of these players who are limping very wide ranges early in these tournaments, hundreds of blinds deep, also tend to make a lot of mistakes post-flop. And we're able to play profitably in position with a lot of different hands. And also, these players are a limited resource. There's only so much time we're able to play this deep against players. And these are opportunities every time we're offered this situation in position to potentially play a hand. And I'm always willing to push the envelope on how much we can get involved, whether it be limping behind, ISOing. But these are opportunities we should be taking advantage of as much as we can.
Yeah, for sure. And I mean, you're throwing in one blind, so it's not even that big of a risk, right? Like, let's
Absolutely.
take the spot. Maybe we'll end up in a sweet situation. Worst case scenario, you
Yeah.
make a
I
post flop
say one
fold.
blind and then I see all my chips going in the middle at the end. What, how did this happen?
Oh yeah. Well, live by the sword, die by the sword.
Right.
All right, so on to the intermediate stage. After re-entry has closed with maybe half the starting field remaining, what's your advice for this stage of the tournament?
I think focusing on play around the button, it's kind of the phrase I like to use where a lot of players are uncomfortable in these situations where you're opening the cutoff, you're opening the button, or you're in the big blind, and you're playing these 40, 50, 60% ranges. And playing big pots with these wide ranges is, I think, a spot that comes up frequently just because of how often we open and how often we defend the big blind spots like that. And another thing where I think players make a lot of mistakes in spots like these, even professionals. So we actually have some examples of hands I've played and also hypothetical situations on how we proceed in hands against late position opens when we're in the small blind, big blind, and how we proceed differently against different player types, knowing that everyone's going to have their tendencies. And some players like to bluff these spots a lot. Some players, especially tighter recreational players, tighter professionals, kind of less willing to put the pressure on in spots like these. So how to adapt around the button and really win the most money there.
Yeah, that's pretty interesting to hear that that's kind of what you're focusing on. Could you kind of speak to some specifics, maybe a specific example of like how you're changing up, your strategy when you're up against those early position opens compared to late? And obviously you're going to play tighter versus earlier position, but I assume you're going to have a little bit more subtlety to your answer than that.
Yeah, we're going to be looking at sizings and player types. I mean, is it a player who uses a consistent sizing where we don't get any information off of that open? And then also what player type and which player types are we looking to attack and which we're not? We actually have a pretty cool hypothetical example where I gave us 9-7 suited in the small blind and facing a button open. So this is intermediate stages, so call it day two of a tournament, registration's closed, and how we proceed against all of our player types. I'm not sure how deep we're going to go into the player types, but loose recreationals, tight, loose professionals, tighter professionals, how we play differently versus this button open in the small blind with 9-7 suited, when we 3-bet, when we call, how we play post flop. And I thought that was pretty fun to make and should be great for the viewers.
Yeah, I've watched a good amount of those videos, and they are very, very helpful to kind of see how differently you play against these different player types. You categorize five player types. It's kind of a little bit of a simplification because, obviously there are going to be, a loose recreational player is not going to be the exact same as another loose recreational player, but, we have to start somewhere. So you basket all player types into these five types. I don't want to go super, super deep into it, but let's use that 9-7 suited example and give the listeners some meat and potatoes here. So let's compare like a loose recreational player to kind of the opposite, and let's compare them to like a tight pro. What would you say are the sort of biggest differences between how you're playing 9-7 suited in the small blind versus a button open when it's a tight pro compared to when it's a loose recreational player?
Yeah, I'm usually not 3-betting the tight pro as much in this spot where we have to be cognizant of their ranges. So when we talk about a loose recreational player folds to him on the button, he might be playing something like a 70% range, 60, 70% range opening. The tighter pro may be opening something around 40% and probably has some knowledge of how to proceed against 3-bets properly. I mean, the tight pro probably calling too tight, but still calling and then playing competently post flop. So we have to think about that. Is that really a spot we want to attack and we want to put a lot of money in the pot pre-flop against a tighter player? Or are we comfortable just calling against a tight player, knowing that this player's weaknesses probably come more post-flop in not finding bluffs and not putting as much pressure on us post-flop? So against that tighter pro, I really feel comfortable calling out of the small blind. Playing post-flop, I think I'm going to be able to hand read better than most of these players, and I don't really want to get into a spot where I'm playing a big pot out of position against a guy who has a tight range.
Yeah, for sure. And it's not just that he's calling your 3-bet properly, he's also maybe opening a little too tight on the button, so he might sort of accidentally defend the correct frequency, right? Because he's just opened a little tighter than he was quote unquote supposed to, right?
Absolutely. And that's something with the loose recreational player and especially the loose professional player when I did this little hypothetical that when these guys do add to their opening range and instead of opening 55%, they're opening something like 70, 75%, we have to understand that they're adding hands to their range that are never going to be calling 3-bets, especially at this depth. So that really makes us want to attack these player types. And with loose recreational players, it's going to depend on what type of player they are. Like, do we want to bloat the pot here out of position against this guy? Are they going to raise fold a lot? Who's in the big blind? So we have a lot of factors, but it was nice that I was able to build these custom simulations where I could really tweak all the details and show how we adapt to what's going on.
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense. And it, yeah, it's just super useful to get those insights into how to play against these different player types, because you really run into all of them in tournaments. And, you know, you might be running into them with a lot of money on the line. So you got to know how to proceed.
Absolutely. And it was nice also to have Nick on, where before we do any of these hypotheticals, we go to Solverland, we take a little field trip with Nick and see how things play versus a computer or versus an elite high stakes regular. So we kind of understand the theory and how things should work. And then we go into our deviations and exploitative stuff.
Yeah, good stuff. All right, let's move on to what can either be a very fun or unfun part of the tournament, depending on your stack, the bubble stage. In the course, you split it up into the soft bubble stage and the hard bubble stage. Can you explain the difference between the soft and hard bubble stages and give our listeners some advice for navigating both of them?
Yeah, I'd define the soft bubble stage as anywhere where it's 2x the players that are in the money. So if the tournament's paying 20, now we're down to 40 players are left, is kind of when I start to consider ICM implications, tournament life a little more, and kind of have lumped hands into the soft bubble phase. And then hard bubble being any time that we could reach the money this hand. So usually in most tournaments, that's hand for hand. Obviously it depends on field size, where sometimes we're one off the money, sometimes we're three or four off the money, but hard bubble being it could happen any moment, it could happen this hand. And the thing I tried to focus on these bubble stages, and also ICM, where there's a lot of parallels between the hard bubble stage, soft bubble stage, and final tables in ICM, is avoiding untenable situations on later streets where we're going to be under a lot of pressure by cleaning up our preflop ranges and really avoiding tough spots later when playing against opponents who cover us, or we could be under a lot of money pressure by cleaning up our opens, cleaning up our defends. And then on the other side of that, putting pressure on opponents who are making these mistakes and defending too wide and opening too wide. And we really take a hard look at RFI on the bubble and how we open into different stacks and different player types behind us, because that's something that changes a lot tournament to tournament. And there's a lot of money to be made in these bubble stages.
Yeah, maybe we can kind of use that 9-7 suited example again, just to kind of carry it through to this part of the episode. So say you're on the button as the opener, or you're in the small blind with like 9-7 suited.
Mm-hmm.
How would you sort of change how you play a hand like 9-7 suited from the small blind versus a button open when you have like a short stack and the button, you know, has a big stack, or maybe you have a medium mm-hmm. stack, or when you have a big stack yourself and the button, you know, maybe has a mid stack?
At these bubble stages, a lot of these spots are dictated by stack size almost more than player type. So if we have a solid player on the button opening and we're in the small blind, 20 blinds, 9-7 suited, hard bubble, that's kind of a pretty easy fold, where we're not really going to get involved in spots where, like I said, that may be untenable post flop, where if we don't flop two pair plus, we're going to be bluff catching at best, out of position against a player who's going to be putting a lot of pressure on us. Where if we have a guy who's a loose opener, let's call it a loose professional on the button, opens with 50 effective, we're in the small blind and we have 100 blinds, this is a spot where we attack and we three bet and put a lot of pressure on a guy who now the onus is on him, where he may be under pressure later in this hand and he has to deal with all those implications and we are the aggressor. And that's usually how these bubble spots play, where there's a lot less flatting and things like that and more pressure threatening people's stack. And the idea of the threat of the threat is kind of a topic that we talk about a lot in this.
Yeah, that makes sense. It's just so brutal in that spot. I mean, even in the big blind, if you have that 20 blind stack that you kind of alluded to there and the button opens, can you even really defend 9-7 suited? I mean, what are you hoping to happen? Do you even want to flop a draw at that point?
Right?
It doesn't feel like it, right?
Yeah, and it's a similar situation to final tables. When you have ICM, you have short stacks abound and you're in these middling third, fourth, fifth place in the final table, you're playing against a chip leader and you have to decide, oh, do I want to enter into this scenario where I know I'm going to face a lot of pressure? And we talk with Nick and we look at actual computer ranges, ICM stuff, and when we don't have to and when we actually do have to enter these situations and fight.
Yeah, it makes sense. I guess one way I'd put it is you kind of end up overfolding preflop in some of these spots in order to make your range significantly more competitive on those later streets, so you don't have all these kind of speculative hands in your range, and then now you're playing the somewhat loose range post-flop. You just fold all that stuff pre-flop, you go to the flop with a very strong range, and it ends up playing a lot easier for you, and you avoid ICM disasters.
Yeah, you really avoid a lot of these turn and river compound mistakes where you've made a little mistake pre-flop, maybe a little mistake on the flop, and then all of a sudden you're having to call off in a heavy ICM pressure spot against a player who's, you're unsure of their range, they're capable of bluffing. So we really talk about those spots a lot in this stage.
Yeah, and it's so valuable too, because that kind of mistake can really cost you, you know, 20, 30, who knows, 100 buy-ins for that tournament, you know, if it's a big enough ICM mistake. All right, so moving on to the next stage, the bubble has burst and we've locked up some cash. What's your advice for this initial in the money stage?
Yeah, this is an interesting stage of the tournament where oftentimes when the bubble bursts, there have been a lot of players there short mid stacks kind of waiting around, and they are now relieved of this ICM pressure where they've been playing very tight. They don't want a bubble. And now you may look around at your table and there's a bunch of guys sitting there with 8, 10, 12, 15 big blinds, and they're all clapping and they're ready to go all in. So it's like, be aware of that. And when you get dealt 5-6 suited in the low jack, like, probably don't want to open it at this stage in the tournament, because these guys are all ready to go all in when they have king queen now, and it's a different scenario than it was earlier in the tournament. So adjusting our preflop ranges and our get in ranges, knowing that the state of the tournament has changed, and this is a phase of the tournament where I think money goes in pretty light. So if it is part of the tournament where you go on a rush, get a lot of good cards, make good hands, this can be another stage where you can accumulate a lot of chips, just because get in ranges are often a little looser than they should be at this stage, just because of the emotional roller coaster, I guess, of the bubble, especially anytime there's a lot of recreational players involved.
Yeah, I mean, they probably feel like they're free rolling, right? So like, let's see if we could spin this thing up.
Yep.
I'm not going to wait around. Like, I'm Absolutely. Getting my 15 blinds in.
Absolutely.
Yeah, another thing I've noticed in stages like that, I know the ICM pressure isn't super significant because pay jumps are not going to be super significant, generally speaking, right when the bubble bursts. That said, though, in a large field tournament, World Series Poker Main Event's a good example, they really drop like flies at that stage. Like, I have never seen hundreds of players bust faster than, you know, day four of the main event, bubble just burst. If you've ever been there, it is so fun because that number just keeps ticking down.
Just ticking down.
Exactly, and you're just picking up like 2K every 30 minutes or so. You're adding to, you know, the prize that you've locked up. So it's very fun once you reach that stage.
Yeah, I've always thought, like, I'm not much of a staller, but, like, all these guys are stalling on the bubble. Like, you should be stalling at this stage when there's 10 people dropping every 5 minutes so you can catch a pay jump.
But so true.
It does go really quickly after the bubble burst.
Yeah, no doubt. All right, onward to the deep in the money stage. Things are starting to get real now with just a handful of tables left. Emotions tend to run high at this point as potentially life-changing money is in sight. What's your tip for this stage of the tournament?
I mean, this is obviously a crucial stage of the tournament, and we talk a lot in this course about the idea of zooming out and stopping to assess what's going on at your table, what's going on in the tournament, and this is a stage of the tournament where we really need to take a moment and do this on a couple fronts. One being, who's at your table, what is their emotional situation, kind of reassessing their mental state, because in these big field tournaments, you get guys that are just happy to be there. They've never really been on a run like this. This is a big buy-in for them, and they're kind of just along for the ride, and whatever happens, happens. There's professionals in there who are dialed and are playing to win or trying to accumulate chips, win the tournament, or playing well. There's professionals in there that are a little over their head and playing tight and just trying to survive and have had a short stack for days. So really assessing what each player is doing, how they're approaching each spot is important. And then also assessing the tournament as well, like zooming out and looking at the field composition, the payouts, how does our table rate against the skill level of the rest of the tables in the tournament? Do we need to adapt our play? Do we have a good table, a bad table? How are the chips distributed? Are there weak players with a lot of chips at different tables? Are there weak players at my table with a lot of chips now? A lot of these little things can dictate our strategy and make subtle changes to our ranges, but things that I think can be very important deep in these tournaments.
Yeah, like in short, it sounds like what you're saying is you really have to look at all of this wealth of information, all of these factors, and then really critically think, how should you adjust? And that's important in all of poker, obviously. Like, if you're at a cash game table, everyone's got 100 blinds, or maybe one guy has 150, whatever, you should always be critically thinking, figuring it out. But it's really magnified in tournaments, right? Because there's so many other things. You're talking about looking at other tables even. Like how does my table compare to the other tables? You know, if you're at a tough table, I suppose that means you're going to be a little bit more careful, right? Because, you know, you kind of want to survive to get out of that table. Would that be kind of like one example of how you might make a little adjustment?
Yeah, if we had a tough table with two or three tables left and there were a lot of very weak players at the other table, I would probably be avoiding any high variance situations or playing big pots when I didn't have to. If I knew I might have some very profitable situations later, if I can survive until the redraw, until players get shuffled around. And that's something that's crucial when thinking about poker tournaments in general and strategy, where, yeah, if we're two tables left and we're playing against 17 Nick Petrangelos, then yeah, let's play baseline, let's play the charts, and there's not much to think about, where we're going to be playing against strong players who are playing the right ranges in GTO-ish poker, so there's not a lot of variables. But most of the time in these big field tournaments, that's not how it is, where there's a lot of wild cards and there's a lot of information out there that should be used to adjust your strategy.
Yeah, that makes a lot of sense. Really important stuff. And I mean, I think one thing I'd urge everyone listening and watching to do is, even if you don't have the exact right answers, you know, you don't have them at the time, but you're in this big spot, that doesn't mean you can't zoom out and do your best and try to critically think. You may not have all the answers. You may not have taken Darren and Nick's course yet. You know, you may not have a ton of experience, but you stopping, zooming out, and taking some time to critically think is still going to be better than skipping that step. You just got to do it. And it's something that could literally be the difference between you locking up a life-changing score and, you know, cashing for disappointing peanuts, you know? So
yeah,
super important stuff. All right, so now hundreds or thousands of players have fallen and you're at the final table. What advice would you like to share with the aspiring trophy winners listening?
The final table, it is similar a bit to this deep in the money stage, where it's important to continue to monitor your opponents and their emotions in these spots, because especially recreational players, you get guys who are just happy to be there at the final table. You get guys who are really grinding the money jumps, where this is life-changing money and every spot that gets eliminated is a big deal to them, so they're trying to ladder. And then you get recreational guys who are, oh, I'm here, I'm free rolling, I'm going to try to win this thing, playing crazy, ignorant of ICM dynamics. So you have to understand, and we bring Nick on a lot for the final table, as I consider him a ICM expert, probably one of the best in the world, how these money jumps and the situation at the final table is going to change the strategy, not only pre-flop, but post-flop, and incorporating that into your game. And also thinking about, how much do my opponents understand this concept? Is this something I can use to pressure my opponents, or do they not even understand? And I'm playing a theory that they're not. So it's important to think about how we should approach these different ICM situations at the final table, and also how our opponents are.
Yeah, it kind of, as you're speaking, I had like a flashback to the one trophy I've ever won in poker tournaments, which was a small tournament in LAPT Panama. It was a $400 buy-in, like turbo. I won it for like 11 buy-ins, but thank you very much. But I remember at that final table, it became so apparent so quickly that no one had any idea what they were doing with regard to ICM. I remember seeing, you know, like min open, early position, also early position rejam, like 27 blinds, which was like third or fourth
a
in
lot,
chips.
Probably, right? Yeah.
Yeah, with fives, like pocket fives. Like, I thought that was one of the better players at the table, you know? So I see things like that, and I'm like, oh, wow, maybe I should, you know, not try to pressure these guys, like potentially, you know, because I had a good stack. I think I was chip leader or so at that point, but even so, it wasn't just, oh, chip leader, the book says I'm the aggressive one, I'm the one who's going to be driving the action. If they're still jamming 27 blinds with fives, which probably isn't even a play at equilibrium with chip EV, then they're probably not the guys who I want to pressure with my big stack. Just kind of let them battle and kind of punt back and forth to each other, and then I'll be waiting there to kind of scoop it up, right?
Yeah, it's important to be flexible with your ranges and who you're playing against and what the situation dictates you should be doing. I've been to a lot of different final tables and had a lot of different player types and how they approach these situations. I've seen a lot of punts of chip leaders pressuring people who really don't care. So, I mean, you have to think about that. And anytime you play against non-professionals especially, they may think of it as a free roll now that they're at the final table. And they may have different ideas of how to play the final table, where, oh, I'm in second, if I can double through this guy in first, I might win the tournament. Not, oh, this is a big ICM risk or anything like that. I might get six. They may be thinking about the other side of it. So it's interesting to assess your opponent's knowledge and how they adapt to different stages of the tournament.
Nice. That was good stuff. So before we kind of move on to heads up play, which is obviously the last stage of the tournament, kind of want to ask you about the long-handed versus short-handed final table sort of dynamic. So obviously ICM is present throughout that at all points. It's only at heads up when ICM stops being a factor completely. But how do you think about ICM changing as you go from, you know, 9 players left to 7 players left to 5 players left to 3 left?
Yeah, it's interesting. And I would even start it at kind of 12, 13 players left where these heavy ICM considerations come in. And you always have to be cognizant of how many handed you're playing, what's going on. Because with 2 tables left, oftentimes it's 5 and 6 handed or something. And you have these very aggressive chip leaders playing shorthanded. A lot of strategy dictated on chip distribution. And then you do reach the final table and it's almost like a new game where now you're sitting 9 handed. Really have to take a second and assess the chip distribution, the stacks. And I often find some of the tightest play being at these spots when it's 9 handed and we have a lot of short stacks, and then always taking time to readjust and recalibrate anytime there's a big pot, because even a short stack doubling up can affect your ranges dramatically. And as players get knocked out, it's important to just be fluid and realize that every final table is going to be different. I've always thought that as things get short-handed, the ICM implications are more clear. I think when there's 4 players left and there's 1 sitting with a short stack, it's a lot easier to see and intuitively figure out than when you're 7 or 8 handed and there's a guy with 12 blinds, a guy with 15, 17, you've got 21, where those spots I think are a little more complicated. And we do have the use of computer models now to help us in these ICM spots, where Nick has really opened my eyes and big part of this course in showing how ranges change and computers play these spots, where you can actually input the payouts and the stacks and see how their ranges shift. It's really interesting to see.
Yeah, no doubt about that. All right, now on to heads up play. What's your advice for when just 1 player stands between you and the lion's share of the prize pool?
Heads up play is interesting, especially in big field tournaments where you really don't know what you're going to be up against. And you can get anything from a top pro to a rank amateur and someone who never plays heads up. So the first thing I think about in heads up in these big fields is, who am I playing against and what kind of edge do I have? Because I want to be avoiding high variance situations anytime I think I have an edge. And a lot of that is linked to stack depth as well, where if you're playing 15, 20 blinds deep, whatever, you can only avoid so many spots with variance. But when playing deeper stacked 30, 50, 70, how do you want to change your strategy knowing that, in general, the more decisions you make your opponent make, the more money you're going to win? Where if this player is going to be someone who makes a lot of errors, pre-flop, post-flop, turn, river, like, you really want to make them make as many decisions as they can. And letting that dictate your strategy and thinking about how much am I going to deviate from baseline theory, which is kind of our ranges if we're playing an elite player, and keeping in mind, most of the time in these tournaments, we do have a kind of unique anti-structure. So how does that affect our strategy that we might have big blind ante playing heads up? Does our opponent understand this strategy? So thinking about that as well is crucial.
Yeah, I've looked at some big blind ante heads up ranges, and it really is wild. I think you VPIP 100% on the button, like in theory, and obviously a very robust limping strategy. But then that's an interesting kind of thought experiment that you made me just think of there, where maybe you're playing an opponent who doesn't realize that, who doesn't realize, you know, when you min open or 2.5 open the button, they're getting incredible odds in the big blind with that big blind ante in there. So maybe they're way over folding, and then all of a sudden you can open a bunch of trash junky hands and they're just going to fold way too often. You're going to way over realize your equity, kind of just steal a bunch of pots. And then alternatively, maybe they do know, and you kind of, you know, they know that they are going to have to defend a lot of hands. And then at that point, you're going to want to have that robust limping strategy with, you know, a bunch of junk in there, some protected hands to kind of protect those junky hands. So yeah, there's kind of a lot of different ways it can go with that, right?
Yeah, that's a good example there, and something I think I've encountered, where if you do have a player who doesn't really understand the math and the odds of the big blind ante and is over folding, there's a lot of hands that baseline or limps, and we kind of have this big limping strategy, especially sub 30 big blinds or something, where we're limping, expecting to get ISO'd light and expecting all of these things to happen in theory when the guy's probably just checking every time he has a bad hand, overfolding when you open. So min opening 100% kind of becoming a pretty attractive strategy against a player like that, where it really depends on who you're up against. And something I've definitely gotten wrong in the past is adapting to this ante and how it affects the ranges.
Yeah, for sure. That's a great point about like the strong hands that would normally be in the limping range. So the way, for the listeners and watchers who aren't familiar with these ranges, the way you sort of build your range when there is an ante in there, a big ante in there, and you're playing heads up, you limp like a ton of trashy hands, and then you also limp some really strong hands, because you can't only limp trash, right? You'll get exploited to death. But a big part of why those strong hands want to limp is because they are supposed to face a fairly aggressive ISO raising strategy. In other words, the big blind is supposed to raise versus that limp.
With some bad hands as well.
Yeah, with some bad hands. I think they're supposed to do it. Do you know the percentage? It's like 15, 20%. It's kind of irrelevant, but it's like a good... The point is, it's a good chunk of hands. And a lot of people, I think even some good players, are going to way underdo it. Some weaker players are going to basically never do it without a strong hand. So now all of a sudden, why would you ever limp on the button with aces? Because they're not going to raise nearly often enough. You might as well just raise. They're going to 3-bet if they have a good hand anyway. So that's how you might as well play it. So theory really, you know, gives way to the more practical strategy there.
Yeah, adapting to who you're playing against, never more important than in heads-up play. And in general, we're going to be making more deviations and more of these adjustments against weaker players, I think, versus top professionals. We're going to be playing closer to baseline as well, but also in live tournaments too, looking a lot at what's going on live, especially if you've been playing with these guys for days. I think a lot of times too, we can look at any kind of live information and things we can pick up off our opponents. Always super important in heads up play, because you're literally looking at the same guy every hand, seeing the same actions.
Yeah, I think I remember in one of your course videos, you talk about when you played a guy heads up. I think it might have been your first World Poker Tour title in like 2013, thereabouts. Mm-hmm. And you had played a hand with him, maybe with four or five left, and you kind of picked up a bet sizing tell from him. I want to say he went smaller when he had not a good hand. Like he kind of had that going on. When he had a strong hand, he kind of bet bigger to quote unquote protect it or whatever. And then you ended up carrying that read over to heads up, and you made a really, really big call down with like ace jack high heads up because of that initial read you got five handed. So that was a really interesting kind of example of, you know, a lot of times you can't make huge inferences between how someone's going to play, you know, five handed compared to heads up, but sometimes you will be able to. You're going to be able to glean certain things about how they approach post flop strategy in general, and that's going to pay huge dividends heads up. And that really speaks to something that you're a big proponent of, which is paying really close attention, phone in the airplane mode, even in your backpack. I even read some comments of people who noticed how observant you are, even in early stages of the tournaments. They said it seemed like you were just seeing everything that was happening. You weren't distracted. And it's probably even got some intimidation factor, to be honest. But more importantly, you're gathering really, really valuable reads at all times. And in this case, it might have led to you winning an extra several hundred thousand dollars in that WPT event.
Yeah, poker tournaments, this is something throughout the course. I mean, you just talked about it. The power of observation. If you're going to try to make any kind of exploitative play and making adjustments, you have to have data to base that off of. And you have to be watching the action, watching hands you're not involved in. And in live poker, it's not like online where you can click last hand and go back and see what this guy bet on the flop. Like, we lose that information forever if you're not paying attention. So to be able to watch bet sizes and pick up on different tendencies, you really have to be watching every street, every hand, hands you're not involved in. And I know some pro players probably rolling their eyes. They hate to hear that, but that's the way I approach the game. And if you want to just play your ranges and be static and not adapt to anything, that's fine. But I don't think that's the best strategy, especially when playing big field tournaments against weaker players who likely have patterns and things that can be exploited. I think it's very valuable to watch the action.
Yeah, no doubt about that. Kind of moving back to heads up for a second, we were talking about how the ranges are kind of specifically built. And one thing that's included in the Road to Victory course are some custom built heads up ranges that Nick worked on. Can you speak to those a little bit?
Yeah, so Nick and I worked together to create these heads up ranges for tournament poker with the big blind ante, and we tried to use stack depths that you frequently end up with at the end of tournaments. So not often do you reach 100 big blind heads up poker at the end of a tournament. So show shallower depths. I think we're going to choose three depths here under 50 blinds, something like 50, 30, 15, or 15, 25, 50. And looking at how the strategy changes, where obviously at 50, we're going to be opening a little more and start to limp more as we get shallower, where anytime you're going to be facing a lot of reshoves, you don't want to be raise folding a lot. So how we build our ranges at these different depths and taking note on how things change and then showing some examples of how these ranges play in game and looking at some hand examples of heads up hands played against top players and recreationals as well in this course.
Very nice. Yeah, and that's not the extent of the chart offerings in the course. Charts are really just the tip of the iceberg in this course, but we do have over 200 equilibrium, you know, sort of solver generated, hand tweaked charts. They were generated with solvers, but then tweaked to kind of make them a little more simpler. You know, no need to have a bunch of 5% and 10% frequencies. We kind of rounded them all by hand to 25, 50, 75, those kind of staples. So it's just a little easier to actually implement in practice. And we have those ranges for six different stack depths, basically 15 through 100. And it covers all of the really common spots, you know, RFI through squeeze and, you know, situations like that. So we have those equilibrium charts so you know sort of how the computer plays preflop in tournaments in all these common spots. And then, as Darren talked about earlier, we have sort of Darren's exploitative ranges, which are these unique situations like, you know, 100 big blind early stage facing a limp or two. What does Darren like to do on the button in that situation? Bunch of other situations like that are covered. Can you speak to a couple of those?
Yeah. I think my exploitative chart's probably one of the more interesting things I work with in this course, where I'm not a huge chart guy, but I just want to visualize for the members and people buying this course what my ranges look like in these different spots and also what my different player types opponent ranges look like. So one thing we did is we open early position, we're deep in the tournament, we get three bet from the big blind. And while yes, we know what the equilibrium range should look like in this spot, contains some bluffs, contains some value hands, yada yada, what does a tight recreational player's range look like? What does a tight pro's range look like? And how do we adapt to that range? So it's interesting to really visualize how different some of these things are than the equilibrium ranges and how we need to adjust to playing against these different strategies.
Yeah, I think that tight recreational one out of the big blind, that's such an extreme and great example where do people ever find bluffs there? Those the guys who are, you know, the quote-unquote tight recreationals, they can just...
Sometimes it's literally zero.
Yeah, literally. And then if they are bluffing, it's often just like kind of an inkling they got, like, let's bluff this hand. So it's that's even hard to quantify. But, you know, you just think about the situation they're in. They can either flick in one big blind or whatever your raise was and see a flop, or they can fold or three bet. So why would, you know, putting yourself in their perspective, why would they three bet without a good hand? Because they could just flick in the one big blind and, you know, see a flop. You know, little do they know that that's a little bit of a problem. And if you have this counter strategy that sort of Darren talks about in the course and has a chart for, you really, really punish them for having the lack of a robust strategy there. So in addition to the charts, there's over 25 hours of content in the course. Like we've talked about throughout this episode, it kind of follows the tournament journey. Videos for kind of every stage of the tournament, goes over hand examples, hypotheticals against different player types, theoretical videos, all the sort of things you need to know to really conquer tournaments. Additionally, there's a section about exploitative ideas. So that's kind of setting you up for the rest of the course so you know some of Darren's favorite sort of counter strategies that he uses against players. So that's kind of what kicks off the course in addition to learning about the player types. And then you really follow Darren and Nick on this journey.
Yeah, and also mixed in there a lot of little mindset tips I have that I've kind of picked up over 20 years of playing poker, like the way I think about different stages of the tournament, the way your mind should be going through the tournament, the way you need to approach observing players. Really had a lot of fun making this with Nick. One of my favorite parts, I think, was even this final table review where we looked at a major online final table that I won during COVID and actually went through every hand commentating with Nick and observing and talking about the strategy of every hand, even hands we're not involved in, breaking things down, playing against elite players in a 10K online tournament. I think the viewers will enjoy that.
For sure. Another thing I really think everyone's going to enjoy is seeing the rapport and the back and forth between you and Nick, because you're obviously both elite players, but you have different skill sets within the category of being elite players where, you know, you are kind of, as I would put it, an exploitative poker master. And Nick is, you know, in the mix against top guys playing 100Ks all the time. So he's basically a computer. So you have these two people discussing strategy and you learn so much from their back and forth. And I imagine you guys even learned a bit from each other while making this course.
Absolutely. Definitely learn some things. Anytime I'm in Solverland with Nick, you learn some interesting things. And I think that's a good point. Just different perspectives on how we approach the game, where we came up together and we played a lot online together. And I would say we focus on different tournaments where he's traveling, playing these Triton things, and I'm mostly playing in the States. We cross paths occasionally in a World Series 100K or something like that. But definitely used to playing against different player types, which is kind of morphed the way we think about the game and how we can win the most money. So it is interesting to hear the different solver perspective versus the exploitative perspective, and how we're both willing to listen and adapt and incorporate ideas from the other is important.
All right. I'm very excited for people to check out this course and to hear all the guaranteed positive feedback we're going to get. And I'm excited for some one or two people to win a World Series of Poker bracelet this year who took this course, because it really is the perfect prep for the upcoming World Series of Poker. If you want to get this course, head over to upswingpoker.com. It's going to be easy to find. Go under the training tab, click the Road to Victory Ultimate Tournament course in the menu, and then buy it. There is a special launch week offer. You can learn the details there. But even if you miss that launch week offer, if you're listening to this later on, it's still absolutely incredible value, and you should absolutely check out Road to Victory. So with that said, thank you for listening. Thanks, Darren, for coming on. Take care.
No problem. See you guys.